Good afternoon. Welcome back to the conference room. I'm happy to announce a third panel which will deal with general enforcement issues in international arbitration and which will also discuss a Yukos 15 billion award. I'm happy to leave the floor to the to moderator of this panel, Professor Danielle Morris. Thank you.
Thank you. So thank you all for being here today. Just to briefly introduce the panel, you have everyone's bios in your conference booklet, so we won't waste our time on that, but just to briefly identify our panelists, we have Henry Weisberg, a partner at Sherman and Sterling in New York. To his left, Betsy Hellman, counsel at Skadden Arps, also in New York. And then to my right, Andrei Panov, a senior associate at Norton Rose in Moscow. And then on his right, Marin Carlson, a partner at Sidley Austin in DC. So Henry is going to kick us off with the first discussion, and we'll go from there.
Good afternoon, and it's great to be here. So I, along with a lot of other people at my firm, represent the shareholders who are the claimants in the Yukos case. So what I'm going to do, since I think pretty much everything we're going to talk about has come up in the Yukos case, which is one of those cases in which, you know, everything that could possibly happen has happened. So I'm going to start with really just a presentation of some of the things that are going on in Yukos, which of course is famous or infamous for having produced a $50 billion arbitration award. So I'm hopelessly partisan. Don't look to me for neutrality. Although I will try and be honest. There are things happening literally in about 10 different jurisdictions. I'm only going to discuss a few of them, or I could be here until midnight. Helpfully or unhelpfully, we're in the middle of the story, and a lot of the things that I'm going to discuss have not been resolved and are simply open and pending. In any case, by way of background, Yukos was formed in the really wild days after the collapse of the Soviet Union in 1993 as an entity to hold a lot of the Russian oil and gas assets. Of course, Russia is very rich in undeveloped oil and gas. Fast forward over the next 10 years, Yukos was privatized. And so by 2003, which is really the relevant year for the start of this story, Yukos was a private, vertically integrated oil company with listed on various exchanges, including via ADRs in the United States, via ADRs in the United States, and had a market cap of at least $33 billion. In that year, as we see it, the Russian government began a very tough expropriation effort against Yukos, accompanied famously by a lot of thuggery, people beaten up and thrown into jail. But for present purposes, the main device for this expropriation were massive confiscatory taxes. And just by way of indication, in some years, Russia contended the taxes due exceeded the gross, not net, the gross receipts of the company for the sale of oil. And ultimately, Yukos was driven into bankruptcy. It was dismantled and no longer exists. And its assets are now largely held by other Russian state-controlled companies. We were engaged, and in February of 2005, we started an arbitration on behalf of what the group that we call the majority shareholders. 70% of the equity was owned by our clients. And this arbitration was commenced under a treaty called the Energy Charter Treaty, which was a post-Soviet treaty largely entered into or signed by both Western European states and the former Soviet states. And this arbitration, by virtue of the ECT, the Energy Charter Treaty, was governed by UNCITRAL rules. And by agreement of the parties, the seat of this arbitration was in the Netherlands. And the actual arbitration was held, and there were many, many hearings. The arbitration was actually heard in the famous Peace Palace in The Hague. Very distinguished, about as distinguished a tribunal as you could get, Yves Fortier, a very well-known Canadian arbitrator and former diplomat, was the chair, selected neutrally. Russia appointed Stephen Schwebel, a very distinguished American arbitrator who for a long time was on the International Court of Justice. And we appointed somebody who resigned, and then the final guy who sat through most of the arbitration appointed by our side was a very well-known Swiss arbitrator named Charles Ponce. initially, and this is a very good illustration of sort of the cycle of events in a big arbitration. Of course, the Russian side challenged the jurisdiction of the arbitrators, and they did it on the basis of a provision of the ECT. So one thing about the ECT is Russia executed it, they signed it, but it was never adopted or ratified by the Duma, the legislature of Russia. So it never technically entered into force. However, it had a provisional application provision, which is something that you see in treaties from time to time, and I'll read it to you, and there's been an unbelievable, probably tens of millions of legal fees have been spilled on this one sentence. And it says, each signatory agrees to apply this treaty provisionally, pending its entry into force, to the extent that such provisional application is not inconsistent with its constitution, laws, or regulations. And I think it's agreed that provisional application is not illegal under Russian law, so we maintain that this provision binds Russia to the entirety of this treaty. Huge, a subject of huge debate, however. The arbitrators took the jurisdictional challenge first. The case was bifurcated and devoted 4 years to considering jurisdiction. There were weeks and weeks of hearings. 23 witnesses were heard from, and they ultimately issued a 2-to-250-page award on jurisdiction in which these three arbitrators unanimously found there to be jurisdiction. They then moved on to the merits, also a very protracted proceeding. Thousands of documents were submitted to the arbitrator. 22 witnesses were heard. Very interesting to me. Russia offered not one fact witness, only expert witnesses. Again, the tribunal took a long time to deliberate and unanimously found there to have been an expropriation, which was, of course, not compensated, and awarded $50 billion to our clients. And that was in July of 2014, so 9 years after the request for arbitration was delivered. In efforts to enforce this award, we commenced proceedings of various kinds in the United States, in England, in France, in Belgium, in Germany, and in India. Of course, the Russian side started a proceeding to set aside the award in the seat. So they went into the first instance court in The Hague. And just to show you what kind of incredible roller coaster this has been for us, in April of last year, the first instance court in The Hague set aside the award on the basis that, contrary to the findings of the arbitrators, there was no jurisdiction because there had not been an agreement to arbitrate. Of course, we have challenged that, and it is now in the intermediate appellate court in the Netherlands. Unlike what we all know about US courts, the first level of appeal in the Netherlands is totally de novo. You can put in new expert evidence. The court pays minimal deference to the decision of the lower court. So we have a whole new ball game. We don't know what's going to happen, of course, but we're very hopeful. And we filed our principal appellate papers just earlier this month. And like any other court, it's hard to say how quickly they'll decide, but roughly speaking, we'd expect a decision on this first instance appeal in the second half of 2018. So again, not quickly. Now turning to the U.S. courts, very interesting proceedings there. So we filed a petition to confirm the award, and there are many, many Russian-related assets in the United States, so obviously that's a condition precedent to going after those assets. We filed that in November, and these dates, we'll test you on them, but they're sort of important. So we filed that proceeding in D.C. In November of 2014, so 4 or 5 months after the award was issued. We did it, as I'll get to in a second, under the Foreign Sovereign Immunities Act. Service under the Foreign Sovereign Immunities Act is a huge nuisance. One thing, just by way of interest, you have to, under the FSIA, you must translate your award into the language of the sovereign that you're seeking to enforce the award against. We had 800 pages of award, and it had to be translated into Russian, was rendered in English, and that is not something you can do in a weekend, I can promise you. Second, under the FSIA, for those of you who studied it, you know there's like a waterfall of steps to try and serve, and most of them are hopeless. Like, you mail it to the other side, and you never get, but you're supposed to get a receipt back. Of course, when you're suing a sovereign, you never get that receipt back, but you have to wait. In any event, ultimately, we got to the service method of going through the State Department. The State Department sends it to the embassy in Moscow to deliver it to the foreign ministry. In our case, the embassy in Moscow lost our papers. Ultimately, they found them, but that's why it takes so long to get these cases going. So two major responses came in from the Russian side, now a changed counsel, now represented by White and Case. They'd been represented by Cleary in the arbitration. As those of you who have studied arbitration know, the general base, well, the first thing they challenged was subject matter jurisdiction. As those of you who have studied arbitration know, for most awards, non-sovereign awards, the premise for subject matter jurisdiction is Section 203 of the Federal Arbitration Act. When it comes to sovereigns, you have to lateral over to the FSIA, to Section 1605, I think it is, and which provides for subject matter jurisdiction to enforce arbitration awards against sovereigns if the award was issued under a treaty to which the U.S. is a signatory. And of course, the New York Convention on the Enforcement of Arbitration Agreements and Arbitration Awards applies to this award. So we argued that there was subject matter jurisdiction via the New York Convention. Russia said, well, no, we never agreed to arbitrate, so therefore you're not under the New York Convention, therefore you should be out of court. There are two things that we say were wrong with that. First, the burden for subject matter jurisdiction under the FSIA is a very low burden. It's been described by the DC Circuit, not as a burden of persuasion, but just as a burden of production. If you show up in court with an arbitration agreement and an award issued under that arbitration agreement, then there's subject matter jurisdiction. If there are defenses that there's some kind of imperfect agreement to arbitrate, well, that's for confirmation, that's not for subject matter jurisdiction. So that's one point. The second point, which to me is the much more important point, and I think a very important point for international arbitration generally, is that the Russian argument about no subject matter jurisdiction basically ignores the arbitration, ignores the decision of the arbitrators. And there's a very important case, I think I find in my own practice, probably the most important Supreme Court decision that relates to international arbitration, is the first options decision from 1995, in which the Supreme Court said, a court must defer to an arbitrator's arbitrability decision when the party submitted that matter to arbitration. And so did the parties in this case submit the question of arbitrability to the arbitrators? And the answer to that is an unequivocal yes, they did. And there are two ways that that was done. One is, as I said, the parties adopted in the treaty the Unsatral rules, and Unsatral Rule 21 says, the arbitral tribunal shall have the power to rule on objections that it has no jurisdiction, including any objections with respect to the existence or validity of the arbitration clause. So the very rules that the party selected to govern their arbitration submits this question to the arbitrators. But much more fun in this case, and this case has been a load of fun, is there's a fabulous letter in the record from Cleary Gottlieb, signed by not one but two Cleary partners, addressed to the arbitrators, which addresses, and this is shortly after the request for arbitration was served, and addresses a number of issues. But one thing it says is, this is Cleary Gottlieb, Russia's counsel speaking, you know, we've had these requests for arbitration for some time, and then the letter goes on to say, quote, the Russian Federation during that time has reached the determination to accept the jurisdiction of this tribunal to determine its own jurisdiction and has participated fully in the process of constitution of the tribunal. So our response on subject matter jurisdiction is that it's really beyond debate that there is subject matter jurisdiction. As we'll get to, this is one of those things that's not yet decided. Another argument they made on subject matter jurisdiction is that the New York Convention only applies to commercial disputes. And they say, well, this isn't really a commercial dispute. It's, you know, it's all kinds of other things, but it's not a commercial dispute. The problem with that is there's a provision of the Energy Charter Treaty which reads as follows. Claims submitted to arbitration hereunder, and this is the arbitration article 26 of the ECT, claims submitted to arbitration hereunder shall be considered to arise out of a commercial relationship. So again, we think that that argument is also foreclosed. For those interested in this, there's also a recent decision of the DC Circuit in a case called DIAG, D-I-A-G, which sort of supports the same conclusion. The other thing that Russia did, not only challenge subject matter jurisdiction, is they challenged our right to have, even if there was subject matter jurisdiction, to have the award confirmed. And they, again, got back to the same argument. There was no agreement to arbitrate, so how can this award ever be confirmed? And then, in another argument, which I think is just completely at odds with what we all believe about arbitration, they argued vociferously that the arbitrators got the facts wrong. They just got the facts wrong. And they submitted, we lost track, but something like 700, 800, 900 exhibits, factual exhibits, including hundreds of exhibits that had been exhibits before the arbitrators. So they, again, our motto has been, this is just a do-over. You know, they want a do-over. Asking this court to look at the same documents that the arbitrators spent 4 years looking at. To most of us, that is not the way that, there's no provision of the New York Convention which says a court has a right to refuse to recognize an award because the arbitrators got the facts wrong. In any event, that was also, is still hanging, pending, because we thought we did the adult thing when the Dutch court set aside the award, we asked for a stay. And said, let's let the Dutch proceedings, go through their process, and then we will get back to the courts. We asked this both, as I said, there was an English proceeding and a U.S. proceeding. We asked for the same agreement in both courts. Russia was represented by the same counsel in both courts. That counsel said, we will agree to stay the English case. We will not agree to stay the US case. We asked, what's the difference? What's the explanation? We never got an answer. Of course, when in the course of briefing our stay application, we only brought this to the attention of the court about 100 times. There was never an explanation given as to why a stay was okay in England but not in the U.S. And in the decision on the stay, the court made particular note of that failure to explain the difference. In connection with the stay, the Russian side also argued that because they had challenged subject matter jurisdiction, the D.C. court lacked the power to issue a stay. We didn't really have much trouble with that because there's Supreme Court law to the contrary. Oh, ancient Supreme Court, 19th century Supreme Court law to the contrary. They also argued that there was no point in a stay because the Dutch proceedings were really irrelevant, so we don't need to wait for those. As we argued, and as the court ultimately pointed out, that was a little inconsistent with the 30 or 40 pages that had been devoted to in prior briefing by the Russian side to the significance of the Dutch proceedings. In my favorite argument, personal favorite, they also argued that there had recently been a downgrade in the Russian credit rating for their bonds, and that was because of the pendency of our case, and because on a stay application one must consider the downside or the harm to both parties, and Russia was obviously being harmed by the pendency of this case because their credit rating had been downgraded. The problem with that argument is that helpfully, the credit rating agencies issue long discussions as to why they are issuing downgrades. And there was a particularly articulate such discussion from Moody's where they listed the reasons for their downgrade, including the military confrontation in the Ukraine, of course the invasion of Crimea, escalating sanctions against Russia, infrastructure bottlenecks, shortfall in labor skills and education, an unnecessarily and dangerously high degree of dependence on hydrocarbon sector, demographic shifts, a bad business climate, and weak institutions. They did not make any reference to our case. In September, the stay was granted. And the judge commenting that this case was a paradigm example of a case warranting a stay. And so now the U.S. proceedings are stayed, the English proceedings are stayed, and we're just going to have to see what happens in the Netherlands. One last point of some significance to what others are going to discuss is to look very briefly, and I realize I'm taking up too much time, on what's going on in the French courts. And French courts take a very different view about awards set aside in the seat. And there are several kinds of proceedings going on in France. First of all, we brought a confirmation case, very much like we did in the US and the UK. And this came up after, this case was heard after the Dutch court had already set aside the award, and the French courts, as is their law, they said, we don't care what's happened in other courts. We're not interested in what judges say about an arbitration. We're interested in what the arbitrators said. We look only at the award. We look at the award, and we think this award is fine, and the award is enforced. That's at the first instance court. Of course, there's an appeal pending. Secondly, it is quite a bit quicker and very different than in the U.S. to start to actually exercise your rights as an award creditor in the French courts. So we have already attached and seized a very large number of assets in France. Roughly speaking, I think 11 significant buildings in Paris, a couple of hundred million euros in bank accounts, and similar volume of assets. We've actually been able to attach. If you know about judgment enforcement, there's a difference between attachment and execution. Execution is when you actually get to take the money home. We haven't been able to do that, but we have been able to attach assets. Two things about that, and then I'll be done. In the course of those, in the French courts, there's a particular judge in charge of attachments who's called the enforcement judge. And of course, Russia argued to the enforcement judge that our attachments should be disallowed because the award's been set aside in the seat. the Netherlands. The French court said, we don't, as you know, we don't care about that. We only look at the award. We don't look at what other judges say about the award. So that was rejected. Some of our attachments have been set aside, but in every case when our attachments have been set aside, it is always on the basis that the party we attached, what you would call in US speak, the garnishee, is not an alter ego of Russia. Therefore, their assets are not available for us to satisfy our award against. But in no case have the attachments been set aside on the basis that the award is not enforceable. So that's, and of course, that's all subject to appeal. So this is a litigation riot, and it will go on, I'm sure, way past the end of my career and probably the careers of everybody up here. But that's, in a nutshell, where we are.
Great, thank you very much, Henry. And now we'll turn to Betsy to talk about US rules for the enforcement of awards set aside at the seat and also stays.
Well, so the common understanding, I think, is that where the New York Convention is applicable, that confirmation enforcement of awards in the US is relatively automatic. That's generally true, but there are two important areas, both of which Henry has touched on, where courts have some measure of discretion in this regard. One is whether to stay the enforcement pending the outcome of set-aside proceedings in a foreign jurisdiction. And two is whether to enforce the award even though it was set aside at the seat of arbitration. So let's first talk about the discretion of a district court to enter a stay. So traditionally in the arbitral context, two grounds have been cited as the authority for a district court to stay enforcement of an award pending set-aside proceedings in a foreign jurisdiction. One is Article 6 of the New York Convention, and the second is a district court's inherent discretion to manage its own docket. So Article 6 of the New York Convention, to take that first, says if an application for the setting aside or suspension of the award has been made to a competent authority, the authority before which the award is sought to be relied on may, if it considers proper, adjourn the decision on the enforcement of the award and may also, on the application of the party claiming enforcement of the award, order the other party to give suitable security. So there's a couple things I think to note about this text. One is that it provides for the possibility of security, which may not be, on the other ground I mentioned, the inherent authority may not be as readily available to you in a US court. The other thing to notice is that it doesn't actually say which party can request a stay. In other words, it doesn't specify that it's specific to the award creditor or the award debtor. And in fact, doesn't actually even mention it being on application of a party, so it seems to contemplate that a court could do it sua sponte. So the leading case on a court's discretion to stay under the New York Convention is the Europcar Italia versus Maialino Tours, which is a Second Circuit 1998 decision. So there, the award creditor had commenced confirmation proceedings in Italy. Then while the Italian proceedings were pending, then went to the Eastern District of New York seeking recognition and enforcement of the award. The award debtor opposed the enforcement and sought a stay pending the outcome of the Italian proceedings. And the district court there declined to enter a stay. So the case went up to the Second Circuit. And the Second Circuit said, well, we have two competing concerns here. One is that stays generally work against our approach to confirmation, which is expeditious resolution and enforcement of the awards, and it could be abused. And at the same time, the court said, well, there's actually probably also good reasons to enter a stay. So the Second Circuit ultimately remanded the case back to the district court to think about whether it should enter a stay, and it listed a set of factors which then have been broadly used ever since. Those are, one, think about the general objectives of the arbitration, which is expeditious resolution. Two, take into account the status of the foreign proceedings and the estimated time for those proceedings to be resolved. Now, it's those first two factors the Second Circuit said should be given the most weight in the court's analysis. And it's interesting how it turned out in the Yukos case, because I think you asked for an indefinite stay, which arguably has a higher hurdle to meet. And ultimately there, the court gave you a two-and-a-half-year
It's through the end of the first instance.
The first instance. So 2019, I think you're with a six-month check-in. So ultimately, quite a long stay was entered there. So the third factor for the district court to consider is whether the award sought to be enforced will receive greater scrutiny in the foreign proceedings under a less deferential standard review. And the fourth is the characteristics of the foreign proceedings. So were they sought to enforce the award? Were they sought to set aside the award? And there, the Second Circuit had some interesting commentary. They said, take a look at whether basically the plaintiff has created its own problem by bringing proceedings in two different jurisdictions at once. Can we sort of place the blame for the comity concerns that arise out of that, of being in two different jurisdictions? And so if you've created your own problem, the court may take that into account and be less willing to give you a stay. So the fourth factor, a balance of possible hardships, and then fifth, any other circumstances that might shift the balance towards or against adjournment. You heard from Henry about the stay that was entered by the district, the DC District Court in his case. Interestingly, so as Henry said, the Russian Federation had argued that the district court did not have jurisdiction, and no jurisdiction then under the New York Convention. And so the district court there said, yes, we haven't decided whether we have jurisdiction yet or not, but I am permitted under my inherent authority to manage my own docket to decide whether I want to enter a stay or not. And there the parties seem to be in agreement. The Russian Federation, maybe on one of the only things you seem to be agreement on, you seem to be in an agreement that in your case, that the Europcar factors only applied if the convention applied, and they only applied if the party opposing enforcement sought the stay. So as I described earlier, the text of the convention doesn't necessarily say this, it doesn't say that. And the district court in DC didn't appear to subscribe to that, because even though it noted differences, big differences, between the Yukos case and the Europcar case, it went ahead then and considered the Europcar factors to a certain extent in its analysis. So it will be interesting, I think, going forward, to see whether other courts then extend the Europcar factors onto to when it's considering just under its discretionary authority, under its inherent discretion to stay, whether it applies those factors, and whether it applies them whether you're the award creditor or the award debtor. And as I mentioned, it could also then, given that there's the two bases for authority, one is if you're the award creditor, and you would like to have security for your award, the convention, as I mentioned, explicitly contemplates that possibility where the inherent authority may not, the courts may not be as sympathetic to that, the U.S. court. So one of the things that the district court, the D.C. district court, when it considered whether to grant a stay or not, one of the things it considered was, well, the Dutch proceedings are ongoing. But if I don't grant the stay and I have to consider things as they stand right now, the award has been set aside. And so then I would have to think about what does that mean? What does that mean? Do I get to enforce the award or not where it's been set aside at the seat? So there is interesting case law development on this subject in the United States. So the convention itself, Article 5, 1E, states, recognition and enforcement of the award may be refused at the request of the party against whom it is invoked if that party furnishes proof that the award has not yet become binding on the parties or has been set aside or suspended by a competent authority of the country in which or under the law of which the award was made. So, as Henry mentioned, just just in 2016, for the first time, a U.S. Court of Appeals weighed in on that topic. That's the COMESA versus Pemex case. That was that case involved a contract to build oil platforms in the Gulf of Mexico between COMESA, which is the U.S. subsidiary of a Mexican subsidiary of a U.S. company, and PEP, which is a subsidiary of Pemex, which is the Mexican state and oil company. The contract there was governed by Mexican law. As these things go, logistical and cost disputes arose, and PEP gave notice to COMESA that it was going to administratively rescind the contract and also seize the oil platforms. Both sides alleged breach of contract by the other, and COMESA then commenced ICC arbitration seated in Mexico, which was provided under the contract. Now, while that arbitration was ongoing, two important things happened. The Mexican Congress changed the available forum for claims that raised issues related to public contracts and vested exclusive jurisdiction for those disputes in a particular court. And when it did that, it shortened the statute of limitations applicable to those claims, effectively. And the second thing that happened is the Mexican Congress enacted a law that ended arbitration for the claims such as COMESA's. So, in the final award, a final award was issued by the arbitral tribunal, and notwithstanding these developments, COMESA prevailed, and in 2009, it had an award for $300 million. So the award was taken to the Southern District of New York, Judge Hellerstein, and he confirmed the award in 2010. And just as a side note, this was under the Panama Convention, not the New York Convention, but those two conventions are generally given similar treatment by the courts. So Hellerstein had confirmed the award. PEP then appealed to the Second Circuit and at the same time then attacked the award in the Mexican courts. So the Mexican courts annulled the award then on the basis that the ICC tribunal had exceeded its jurisdiction by hearing the parties' dispute, given the changes in the law that had happened. So on the basis of that annulment of the award, PEP then went to the Second Circuit, asked it to vacate the district court's confirmation of the award. Second Circuit remanded then to the Southern District to Judge Hellerstein to consider the Mexican ruling. And Judge Hellerstein then, having the case back, conducted an evidentiary hearing and issued a new judgment confirming the award. He declined to defer to the Mexican annulment. So the Second Circuit then reviewed Judge Hellerstein's decision, applying an abuse of discretion standard, and recognized that the convention, as in the language that we read earlier, gives district courts the discretion to enforce awards even where they're set aside, but it noted that the exercise of that discretion is constrained by comity concerns and is only appropriate to vindicate notions of what is decent and just. The Second Circuit, with that pronouncement, though, then held that giving effect to the Mexican judgment nullifying the arbitral award would run counter to United States policy and would be repugnant to fundamental notions of what is decent and just in the United States. And there were a number of considerations animating that decision by the Second Circuit. So, and not surprisingly, were largely tied to those changes in law that I had mentioned earlier. So just to mention a couple of them, they found that the retroactive legislation by the Mexican Congress deprived COMESA of its contractual rights, and that it also left it without any forum to litigate its claim, which it found magnified the injustice. So in making this decision, in rendering this decision, the Second Circuit underscored just how narrow it viewed its decision and said, and I'm going to quote here, any court should act with trepidation and reluctance in enforcing an arbitral award that has been declared a nullity by the courts having jurisdiction over the forum in which the award was rendered. We hold that in the rare circumstances of this case, the Southern District did not abuse its discretion by confirming the arbitral award at issue, because to do otherwise would undermine public confidence in laws and diminish rights of personal liberty and property. So obviously the Camisa case is very important in that it's the Second Circuit weighing in on whether a court can enforce an arbitral award that's been set aside at its seat. In the Yukos case, of course, if depending how things go in the Netherlands, the District Court of D.C. may in fact have be faced with whether to exercise this discretion or not. In the broader context, PEP has submitted its petition for writ of certiorari to the United States Supreme Court, and it will, of course, be interesting to see if the U.S. Supreme Court takes up that issue. PEP has argued that the decision runs contrary to all U.S. notions of comity and quote, invites foreign courts to demonstrate reciprocal disrespect for the judgments of U.S. courts. So basically has said, this will cause international relation problems if this is allowed to stand. And then also presented this as a circuit split. So said the Second Circuit basically had run afoul of prior case law, including the District Court of D.C. In the Termarillo case. So, and then interestingly, I did not see it discussed in their cert petition, but there was a difference in the standard of review that had been applied in the between the Second Circuit and the D.C. Circuit. The Second Circuit reviewed Judge Hellerstein's decision on an abuse of discretion standard, whether he had abused his discretion in not recognizing a foreign judgment, whereas in the Termarillo case, which is other case law that the Second Circuit actually said that it was sort of following on with the precedent. I think the Second Circuit positioned its decision as sort of following prior case law, but that one, that standard of review of the district court's decision was de novo because there, the court had found that there was no award. It had been set aside at the seat, and so there was no cause of action, and so that was something that could be reviewed de novo. So with that, I'll turn it over.
Great, thank you. And now I'll turn to Andre to talk about enforcement against assets of related companies.
Thank you. And I have to apologize. I have a PowerPoint presentation for that. A short one. Thank you. So moving to somewhat more general or broader topic, slightly away from the Yukos arbitration, but I think it might be somewhat related as well. The topic is whether you can enforce an award against the non-parties, i.e. the companies or assets of the companies which were not parties to the initial arbitration. Why this question arises? Basically, what you have on this slide is somewhat how the companies are organized these days. So you could have a creditor, the award creditor, who has a claim enforced against the award debtor, and then you have all sorts of assets under the award debtor. The award debtor might be owing a subsidiary, which can then have its own subsidiary, which then would help hold assets. The award debtor might have a parent company which holds its own assets, and the parent company may have other subsidiaries with the assets. Now, usually what happens, obviously, is when you have an award against an award debtor, you would go after the debtor's assets. Sometimes they might not be available, sometimes they might not exist. And therefore, in some circumstances, the question arises whether or not you can actually enforce against somebody or against the assets of some party which was not involved in arbitration at all. Broadly speaking, there are, let's say, three theories on which you can try to enforce the award against the non-party. One is the theory of piercing of corporate veil, where you basically go after the parent company's assets if, let's say, the debtor's assets just don't exist or are not available for some other reasons. The other thing is the reverse piercing of corporate veil, basically when you go after the subsidiary's assets of the assets which belong in one way or another to the subsidiary of your debtor. Again, the usual way would be to try to enforce against the assets of the debtor. If, let's say, the debtor has shares in the subsidiary company, you would go after the shares, which would probably give you control over the assets. The only problem is that sometimes you don't have shares, and that's why on the slide it says that the debtor is actually the equitable owner of the debtor's subsidiary, which means that there might not be actually the assets against which you, within the debtor, against which you would try to enforce. There might be all sorts of other reasons. For example, the debtor may be located in jurisdiction where you don't believe you can enforce your award against the assets of this debtor, so you would try to go to another jurisdiction for the assets. Now, the third theory is basically whatever you would call it, the single economic entity, single economic reality, or a group of companies doctrine, where you would go after the assets of a sister, of the debtor's sister company, essentially a company owned by the same parent. Again, for exactly the same reasons. I think the slide mentions the case. This one is from Singapore, and the context in which that situation arose was when the award debtor was so-called single ship company. When in the shipping industry you have different limited liabilities company owning one ship, basically to shield the liability, they would have the same beneficial owner, but the assets of the company would be limited to one ship. So in that case, the creditor, when it realized the debtor didn't have any assets, tried to go after the debtor's sister company. Now, the problem with that, there are a few problems with this approach. One is obviously that the jurisdictional one. To what extent the arbitration agreement actually covers whatever company you're trying to involve. And let's, for this matter, look at the reverse piercing of corporate veil. Basically, the question is somewhat twofold. You ask the enforcing court to enforce against the assets which directly do not belong to the debtor itself, so they belong to some other entity. Then the question is obviously whether this entity is a party to an arbitration agreement. And if the answer to this question is yes, then the next question would be, okay, why the enforcement court would have jurisdiction? Because if the entity is covered by an arbitration agreement, obviously you would have to arbitrate against this entity. If the answer is no, and it is not covered by an arbitration agreement, then again, the question is why the arbitral award could be enforced against its assets, because the arbitrators cannot rule against somebody who is not a party to an arbitration agreement which gave them jurisdiction for a particular case. The second problem which arises here is that obviously, at least the pro-arbitration approach in many jurisdictions is that the enforcing court would have very limited authority to review the award on its merits. What happens here, essentially, you ask the enforcing court, rather than your arbitral tribunal, to adjudicate on whether or not the third party shall be bound by an arbitration agreement and shall be liable for the debts of the debtor. Now, obviously, the orthodox approach would be to have the arbitrators decide that case. And it's a big question mark for me to whether or not the enforcing court actually has jurisdiction to deal with this question. Now, the third problem is that when those situations arise, basically, one might argue that the award creditor should be stopped from pursuing those sorts of assets, at least for two reasons. First is that the award creditor, when entered into a contract with the debtor, with the future award debtor, knew what company it was dealing with most of the cases, most of the times. So if they knew, they have accepted the risk that this company might not have assets. They couldn't complain about this post factum. The second problem is that when they were arbitrating their case, they failed to try to drag the third party into the arbitration, which means that the third party didn't have any say during the proceedings. It couldn't present any case because it most likely didn't know about the case or, well, at least wasn't made a party to the case. And then the question is, if the award creditor failed to engage third party at least twice, why on earth should the award creditor be then allowed at the enforcement stage to engage the third party's assets? Now, for that reason, I think in the commercial context, these things are really problematic. In international commercial arbitration, these things are really problematic, and, well, at least to the extent I know, the courts would usually not allow the enforcement against the third party's assets. Now, one might, though, think that in the investor-state arbitration context, the situation is slightly different, because obviously the states usually wouldn't hold the commercial assets directly. They would hold them through various companies, which would be owned in one way or another by the state. Now, unlike in the commercial context, the investor doesn't have an option to make a state-owned company a party to its arbitration agreement, which is usually a provision in the BIT. And unlike in the commercial context, investor doesn't have an option of making the state-owned company a party to the arbitral proceedings in the view of future possible enforcement against the assets of the state-owned companies. I think for that reason, Professor Gaya, I think in 2008, wrote an article where he suggested that given this, the enforcement against the non-parties which are stained on the assets of non-parties to investor-state arbitration against their assets should be allowed in the investor-state arbitration context. I'm sure that article had nothing to do with the ongoing then-ongoing Yukos case. It was just pure coincidence that this topic was discussed. And I'm not suggesting the right answer here, but arguably the investor-state arbitration context might warrant a slightly different approach to the enforcement against the non-parties to the initial arbitration. But still, this might be somewhat questionable and problematic. Thank you.
Great, thank you very much. And then finally, we have Marin talking about attachment of assets, so sovereign actions and commercial assets.
Thank you. And I, too, apologize for having a PowerPoint, but it's really just because I didn't want to have to read out a bunch of text. This is my shortcut to not reading out provisions of law. So it's interesting to me. I want to focus particularly on enforcement in investment treaty, arbitration investment treaty awards, because I was wondering if Henry would take much comfort from the fact that the father of ICSID, when asked about certain provisions of the ICSID Convention that I'll talk about in a minute relating to execution, said at the time that the ICSID Convention was being drafted, in essence, that we didn't really actually need to worry so much about this enforcement thing. He said that, you know, since any state against which an award was granted would have undertaken in advance a solemn international obligation to comply with the award, the question of enforcement against a state was somewhat academic. And that because the host state would have undertaken to abide by the award, the problem of enforcement in a third state was not likely to arise.
Take a lot of comfort from that.
Yeah. So too bad you can't have coffee with him and discuss. But as practitioners in investment treaty arbitration, and we're often, if you're talking to a potential claimant investor, they often ask you the question of, okay, this is a lovely system and all, and it allows me to sue the state in binding our international arbitration for the enforcement of a treaty obligation. Isn't that interesting? Are you sure it's worth doing? What on earth am I going to get at the end of the day? or, you know, to put it in the vernacular, it's show me the money, right? You know, where how am I going to get money at the end of the day out of this somewhat academic-sounding process? And, you know, as counsel, we can often, you know, give them the starting point of the reassurance of, well, the good news is most states pay. And this is actually true, right? However, not all of them. As many BIT award creditors found against Argentina, as Henry knows all too well against Russia, and as I suspect we haven't seen yet for sure, but we'll see what happens with Venezuela, it is not the case that all states pay or have a policy of paying on adverse investment treaty awards. Sometimes the mindset that caused the government to sign the bilateral investment treaty of, you know, wanting to reassure foreign investors and attract foreign investment isn't so powerful when it comes time to facing an adverse award. The rationale that, oh, we should pay these awards because otherwise investors won't be reassured by our bits seems less compelling when they actually have to write a check. And so we come into this question of enforcement. And ultimately, the question of execution, right? Because everything that Henry's been doing so far, except in France, where he's actually gotten to attach some assets, although again, not execute on them, is the prelude to actually getting the money. And so I wanted to spend a few minutes talking about the execution side of the equation. So let's assume we get the recognition, we get the enforcement, we get the judgment in a country. You also would like to get the assets and get the money. And when it comes to that, I think we haven't seen a lot of recognition yet of the fact that investment treaty awards are going to be executed in a system that is not exactly designed for state non-commercial liability, that is state liability for sovereign actions. And to give you an example of that, I'll talk in particular about the U.S. Foreign Sovereign Immunities Act. But let's just start off with, sort of reminding ourselves, okay, investment treaty arbitration. By definition, you have a sovereign respondent, right? The government is on the other side, not a state-owned entity, sometimes a subdivision or sometimes a designated entity, but 99 times out of 100, it is the Republic of X. So the Energy Charter Treaty, just, you know, its jurisdictional article for investor-state disputes is, you know, it's a dispute between a contracting party and the investor. The ICSID Convention, which of course is not itself a source of consent, but it sets up a system for dispute resolution that the Yukos shareholders did not get to use, describes itself as being a place for cases between a contracting state or any constituent subdivision or agency of the contracting state that's been designated by the state on the one side. So you've got a sovereign respondent, the government. And most investment treaty cases, although they don't have to be, but are cases where the claim is about breach of an international instrument, breach of a public international law binding instrument where the state has undertaken obligations in making commitments to other states. It just so happens that the investor gets to enforce them. And so when that's the allegation is breach of a treaty obligation, you're obviously talking about a sovereign action, sovereign liability. And then various of these instruments also impose responsibilities on the sovereigns to enforce international investment agreement awards. So the Energy Charter Treaty itself says each contracting party to the Energy Charter Treaty will carry out without delay any such award and shall make provision for the effective enforcement in its area of such award. The ICSID Convention likewise says that every contracting state to the ICSID Convention is going to recognize an ICSID award and enforce at least the pecuniary obligations of an ICSID award. All well and good, except ICSID Convention Article 54.3 and Article 55. This is where all of a sudden ICSID says, yes, we want a very good enforceable system, except we're just going to punt on execution, right? Because execution of awards is going to be governed by the laws in force in the state where enforcement is sought. And nothing in the ICSID Convention is going to be construed as derogating from the sovereign immunity laws of any state where enforcement is sought. Christoph Schreuer, who's written the definitive commentary on the ICSID Convention, has affirmatively called this the Achilles heel of the ICSID convention, right? Because we've got this lovely system to administer these disputes, taking into account the peculiarities of a dispute between an investor and a contracting state. ICSID even has a self-contained annulment mechanism so that you don't have judicial review, you don't have set-aside proceedings in ICSID awards, you just have ICSID annulment. And then you have this obligation, you have the obligation in Article 54 that states are going to abide by awards and that they'll be directly enforceable as if they're already the judgments of the highest court of the land in every ICSID convention state. Great, except when you want to get the assets. And then ICSID tells you, oh, go look at domestic law, which maybe that's okay. All right, so let's look at the U.S. Foreign Sovereign Immunities Act. Now, the FSIA is about both immunity from suit and then immunity from execution. And the starting point in the FSIA is that the property in the United States of a foreign state shall be immune from attachment, arrest, and execution. It really seems like there should be commas, but there aren't. I actually went back to the original statute. I don't know if, for some reason, nobody wanted to have commas. And so that's the starting point. But as with as is always the case with the FSIA, the key is the exceptions, not the starting premise. So let's look at the exceptions. So it does provide that in certain cases, the property of a foreign state can be attached in aid of execution or can be executed upon, and even property in the United States of an agency or instrumentality of a foreign state. And the exceptions sound pretty promising. If you start to look at the individual exceptions, in particular, exception number 6. So exception number 6 says that the property in the United States of a foreign state shall not be immune from attachment or from execution if it's based on an order confirming an arbitral award rendered against the foreign state, provided that attachment or execution would not be inconsistent with a provision in the arbitral agreement. So this sounds promising. One big problem. Only commercial property. The property has to be in the United States, and it has to be commercial property. And this is the disconnect that I wanted to flag, because you're talking about an investment treaty arbitration award where a sovereign state is being held responsible for a sovereign action, and it's liable under a sovereign instrument. But for some reason, because we're put in the situation of having to use the FSIA, we're limited to commercial assets. Now, and the reason for that as a historical matter is because the FSIA was constructed as an exception from a rule of absolute sovereign immunity. Essentially, governments like the United States and many others said that they were going to adopt a restrictive version of sovereign immunity. Instead of making all sovereign assets immune, they were going to recognize that states had gotten into the business of doing a lot of commercial activity. And so where states were commercial actors, their commercial assets should be vulnerable to execution. But that's not what we're talking about with an ICSID award or with an investment treaty award more generally. We're not talking about a state being involved in commercial activity and therefore having its commercial assets, but only its commercial assets, vulnerable to execution. We're talking about a state involved in sovereign activity and being held liable for its sovereign acts. So I would throw out there as a provocative proposition, maybe even more provocative than what Professor Gaillard said, which Professor Gaillard was saying, okay, well, maybe you should be able to go after the commercial assets of instrumentalities or subsidiaries of the state. Why shouldn't we go after the commercial? Why shouldn't we be able to go after the sovereign assets? Now, we can go through all the arguments about, you know, the importance of comity and diplomatic immunity, and you don't want the military's assets being seized and things like that. And so, you know, I'm not necessarily arguing that this should be the case, but there does seem to be a bit of a square peg round hole problem here. We're trying to shove a sovereign award for sovereign liability into a statute that only allows us to go after commercial assets. And is that the right system, or should we try to make these two systems work a little more seamlessly together?
Thank you very much. So I guess we can open to the floor if there are any questions. Or I can start with a question.
There you go.
So thinking about potential problems with enforcement, either a lack of clarity in the law or differences in standards of enforceability against sovereign assets in different jurisdictions, are there ways that counsel can practically take this into account in advance? You know, other than, for example, in a commercial situation, being careful about who your counterparty is there anything practically speaking that counsel can do to help put their client in a better position for enforcement at the end of the day?
And for the reasons Andre identified, it's hard in investment treaty arbitration.
Yeah.
You don't have that choice of parties.
Exactly.
Yeah, I mean, in commercial arbitration, like statutes like the New York CPLR, the domestic, local procedural law, now the attachment provision was amended not that long ago to permit pre-judgment attachments or pre-award attachment. But that's strictly going to be certainly in commercial cases where it's very useful. In sovereign cases, because of the FSIA, I think it's unless, you know, I guess you're saying, what can counsel do? Well, here's what counsel can do. It's not going to work in an expropriation case, but in Argentina, for example, a lot of the Argentine litigation arose out of bond defaults, right? So you can get, in fact, it was in those bonds, you can get a waiver of the Foreign Sovereign Immunities Act restrictions on pre-judgment attachment to the maximum extent possible. Now, it turns out nobody tried to do that, but in theory, it's available. Mm-hmm. But again, getting back to Marin's point, you have to find those commercial assets. And as we know, in the Second Circuit, there are probably 30 maybe decisions in Argentine cases in the Second Circuit. And basically, and the plaintiffs, basically the hedge fund bar spent like $100 million and they didn't, you know, catch anything.
Right. I mean, at the end of the day, the solution in the Argentine cases has all been political.
Yeah. And to your point, actually, they paid the investment awards
right.
as well. They just paid
right.
them a decade late, but they paid them.
Right. But although, I mean, the Argentine case was the one that resulted in the fund of seizing the Argentine tall ship in Ghana, which ultimately didn't work because it was part of the Argentine Navy. So I still love this idea that all these countries have these tall ships, you know, with big sails, floating around the world, but those are naval training vessels.
So the answer to your question is, in any kind of contractual setting, you should get the maximum waivers.
Right.
But in expropriation, you know, it's hopeless.
Yeah, I agree. I think if it's contractual, you could try to do something, but then the states would usually have many states would usually have a greater bargaining power than any corporation. In the BIT context, I think one of the problems is obviously that the states might be more willing to amend their sovereign immunity acts, but they certainly appreciate that it would immediately backfire. Because you could say, well, yeah, we would go after the commercial assets of whatever grandchildren corporation of that state because, well, we know it's ultimately beneficiary controlled by the state itself. But the problem is that you can't guarantee that at some point you as a state won't be a respondent in another arbitration and your corporations would run the same sort of risk. I think that's one of the reasons why states are so attached to their sovereign immunity acts and are not that willing to lower the sovereign immunity protection.
Oh yeah, was there? Please, there's a microphone just behind you.
I'm sorry, while he's going to the microphone there, on your point, in the U.S., of course, you have you have veil law that applies to sovereigns, the famous Banset case, which is a Cuban Revolution case, which basically says you can't go after unless you can prove that the entity you want to go after, the sovereign entity you want to go after, is an alter ego, or that its operations, works a fraud, you can't necessarily drop, notwithstanding what my partner, Professor Gaillard, may hope, you can't just drop down into those companies.
Sorry, I didn't realize I should stand up. I was hoping to stand up when I speak in the next session, but everyone seems to be sitting down. But, I mean, one long-term solution, if you believe that you'll last long enough, is hold on to your Russian bonds. Eventually, the imperial bonds might be honoured if you hang around long enough. Another practical solution, I found an example in the Azarix case before we even delivered our annulment award, the ad hoc committee in Azarix, had already sold their award. There is a market out there to sell for what members of the panel, we know the conventional discount. And I know at least one operator out of Den Haag who says he will buy any national award because eventually he'll be able to find somewhere where he can enforce it. One example, you remember the lookalike Concorde of about 20 years ago, there was at the Paris Air Show, and they had contacts which told them that the gendarmerie were heading to impound the plane on execution of an arbitral award. So the pilot just powered it up and took off with the bailiffs chasing them down the runway. So that's one way to escape execution. But there are practicalities of that, which we'll probably discuss in the next session. We're talking about litigation funding, but if you're long in patience, you can probably end up getting somewhere, something. As in the case of the Argentinian cases, I'm not quite sure how use for commercial activity in the United States operates, but mostly by and large, if you regard the world as a wide place, you'll find an asset somewhere at sea or somewhere else, be it even just the president's airplane. Is that a commercial purpose or not? One can argue about it. The French president let it go, but another president might keep it. But one can be imaginative, and if your client doesn't have the fortitude to hold on, the client can sell the award for 40% or whatever, and someone else will take it over.
If I may, on the patience point, I think probably that's true that we know that eventually in every state the politicians would change and the governments would change at some point. So I think the best chance the investors have is then to wait for the states which are not paying, wait for the governments to change and for the governments become willing to attract more foreign investments, and then understanding that, well, probably we'd better pay that award. But just one point I recall, I think somebody told me, and I'm not sure, it's just what I heard, that in London insurance market, you could buy an insurance against non-payment by the state. And I was told that basically it covers pretty much every possible state. So I'm not sure how insurers could do that, but if that is the case, probably this is the right solution. And I was told that it's not that expensive.
Well, I think it's called arbitration award default insurance, and I'm not sure that, well, the insurers would know, but I'm not sure that they're actually willing to insure every jurisdiction. So I suppose there's a price for everything, but I do think they pay attention to who's disavowing their bilateral investment treaties and things like that, as to whether they want to insure that against that sovereign not paying its award.
So then, yes, please.
Hello, everybody. Alexandru Stănescu, Columbia Law School. Very interesting presentation. I wanted to ask you regarding the execution of awards of assets within the national jurisdiction of the state's respondents. What was, from your experience, the main way of frustrating, let's say, the execution of awards? Do they de facto not willingly abide by the execution, or do they modify their internal legislation in order to consider that execution is now changed, or do they satisfy the execution in another way? Like, for example, in a case in Europe, they modified the definition of execution and they put the money in a block account and they consider this as execution. Thank you very much.
I haven't had too much experience trying to go after execution of assets in the defaulting countries. Own courts. I mean, I think most of the folks who held Argentine awards, for example, did not go and attempt to enforce them in Argentina with the bid awards. In fact, Argentina was inviting them. He was saying, just come to our courts and we'll enforce it right here. It'll go great. and none of the bid award creditors took them up on that. So I haven't had that experience directly yet.
Yes, speaking for Russia, I think nobody ever tried to enforce the award against Russia in the BIT context, and there were few. Even before Yukos case, nobody tried to enforce that in Russia, so nobody knows how it would work. Well, one could guess, but nobody ever tried that, so no real experience there.
Hi, my name is Zias, and I'm a student at Georgetown Law. I wanted to ask a question, assuming the worst for the Yukos shareholders. Assuming the highest court in Netherlands refuses to reverse the setting aside, do you believe that the award can still be enforced in the United States, considering the fair and just standard set?
Well, I just want to make sure, since I was speaking so quickly, I want to make sure it's clear. So the Camisa versus Pemex case was the first time that a U.S. Court of Appeals had enforced an award that had been set aside. So the issue has been addressed by a U.S. Court of Appeals before, but in the case before that, the Court of Appeals refused to enforce the award that had been set aside at the seat. With that, I'm passing it to Henry.
Yeah, not surprisingly, I don't think I'm going to answer that question. But I would say that the Pemex case, which Betsy addressed, had a level of injustice that, and with the retroactive adoption, et cetera, and the depriving the claimant of any forum, that maybe we wouldn't have in our case. But I don't want to address your question directly, if that's okay.
Thank you.
Yeah. Hi, I'm Mark Cantor. I just wanted to clarify for the audience the availability of arbitration award default insurance. First, you should be aware that insurers will only sell that insurance at the time the investment is being made. They will not sell it at the time when the dispute has arisen, and they will not sell it at the time the award has been issued. Second, all insurers have only limited cover. They specify which countries are available for cover. And unfortunately, a number of the countries that find themselves in investment treaty disputes are not on cover for either public or private insurers. And the third point, it is quite expensive. The U.S. public insurer, OPIC, Overseas Private Investment Corporation, used to have its generic pricing on its website. So you could calculate in those days what, if you had a middle class country, medium risk, what the cost might be. And it was roughly, for full cover, 1% of the face amount of the insurance payable annually in advance on a non-refundable basis. So that if you purchased $100 million of equity political risk insurance, you paid $1 million for each year the insurance was in place, you paid it annually in advance, and it was non-refundable. Which meant, since most investments do not end up in expropriation or similar problems, that was an add-on to the cost of the project that is actually quite significant if you're a commercial party trying to figure out how to make a profit. Thank you.
So Henry, just to follow up a little bit on the Yukos arbitration, so in certain respects it seems quite unique, both the size of the award and some of the background and political circumstances. So I'm wondering, based on your experience, what aspects of the Yukos arbitration and the enforcement have been typical of what you've seen in other investment arbitrations, commercial arbitrations, and what is sort of unique to the Yukos case because of the circumstances?
Interesting question. So the first case I ever worked on was an expropriation in Peru. Our client had offshore development rights and had offshore platforms, and this was during Alan Garcia's first administration as president, when he was a socialist. He later became a non-socialist. But when he was a socialist president, there was no dispute it was an expropriation. He sent the Navy out to take our client's platforms. We had pictures of the naval, of the sailors climbing up the platforms. And it was actually a political risk insurance claim. So we weren't suing the state, we were suing AIG. And we ended up getting 100 cents on the dollar. And so, and much, you know, it was a lot of money at that time. I think it was $200 million, which was a huge amount of money. And, you know, that's not even a day's interest or something in Yukos. Maybe it's more than that. But so, no, I think there's a lot, you know, there is the rule of big numbers, but I think it's not that different. Of course, the facts of the expropriation in Yukos are incredibly dramatic, with Gordakovsky, you know, thrown in jail, and people, you know, I mean, the human toll was very, very high in Yukos, and you know, that was in the background. I mean, that we definitely concentrated on the confiscatory taxes, but the human toll was there. So in a lot of ways, maybe it's not that different than that first case that I had, which is called Belko versus AIG. But I think the what is unusual is, of course, the provisional application provision of the ECT. You know, again, this is a not uncommon feature of treaties, but it hasn't been litigated that often, and it's extremely, even though it's that three lines I read, it's extremely dense in terms of all the issues that triggers. So that's sort of unique. And then we haven't got there yet. But I think, you know, when we heard some of this, I think Russia will not pay. And although, as Marin said, and historically most states do pay. I mean, going back, because there's been these kinds of disputes for centuries. And most states pay. Argentina's unique. I guess Congo has got a really bad track record. And then we have Russia, and we'll see. So I would expect that they would not pay. But enforcement to collect $50 billion is going to be extremely difficult. And Russia does have commercial assets. They are major exporters of all kinds of commodities. They've got commercial operations all around the world. But they're very deeply held through many, many ranks of entities, and they also have corporate type structures which are unique and different than corporation. They're not state agencies, they're not corporations, who the hell knows what they are, you know, and presumably we'll have to litigate, you know, what these sort of non-equity holding enterprises are. So I think a lot, so to answer your very good question, I think a lot of what might make this unusual will be in enforcement, and we're only at the dawn of that.
I invite the other panelists to speak, but from the practitioner's perspective, I think it has been an interesting sort of consciousness raising among clients. I don't know if anybody's had a similar experience, but right, international arbitration, how often are your clients, you know, until they get there really thinking about it? And it is interesting, since there was so much press on it, that a lot of the clients have independently read about it and you know, have followed it. And the $50 billion figure is very eye-catching. So, you know, it certainly has played into discussions with clients.
Yes.
I have a question for Henry.
Hello.
So this is just a point of information only, believe it or not. In the appeal,
George,
in the appeal in the Netherlands, do you know, as a matter of Dutch procedural law, whether the court will entertain any of the other half dozen challenges that were advanced in the annulment action? The annulment court having chosen to annul on the basis of one of several challenges, left the others undecided. And I'm wondering if you could just tell us whether those can, as a matter of Dutch law, be entertained on appeal?
Yeah, so this is Professor Berman from Columbia, for those who don't know him, who I might say has filed an opinion in the Yukos case in D.C., which the judge didn't yet get to. As George says, so when the set-aside proceeding was filed, I I don't know how you count, but there were several dozen arguments made by Russia, and the court selected this provisional application argument and didn't reach all the others. They said, it's got to be set aside on this basis, we're not touching the others. My understanding is that the answer to that is not clear, and that the guess is that if they, it's like the U.S. court, I think, if they want to reach those, they can. If they reverse on Article 45, they can also send it back to the first instance court. So we don't know.
Except on so.
They have said they have. They might reach them all. I don't think it's clear that they will. Yeah.
Any other questions? Yes.
Thank you. My name is Isabella, and I'm from Chicago, from Northwestern University. So about the Yukos case and the similar cases where you have the parallel enforcement in different jurisdictions. So as I understand, France is quite unique in this regard, but the other jurisdictions. If one of the courts decides not to enforce the award, does this have any effect on the other enforcement proceedings? Do the judges regard this as the persuasive authority, or do they look at this at all, or do they enforce it on case-by-case basis in different jurisdictions?
So are you asking if the award is annulled at the seat, and then one court then refuses to enforce on that basis, what do other courts in other jurisdictions, do they pay attention to mm-hmm. whether it was refused at I mean, I suppose that depends from differs from jurisdiction to jurisdiction. But for example, in France, I don't think it would care either way what another court did with it. So I think it sort of depends on what other jurisdiction you're in.
Great. Well, thank you very much.